The Blessed Virgin Mary apparition, posted on November 2013. The viral images of the Virgin Mary captured on a cell phone has become an online sensation. The miraculous photos have confounded Catholics as well as other Christians and atheists who cannot explain the phenomenon. It all happened at the Chapel of Our Lady of Perpetual Help in Glenview, Illinois. This parish belongs to the Archdiocese of Chicago. It is situated on Grove Street, approximately 22 miles from Chicago. A very thought-provoking picture shot with nothing more than a cell phone caused quite an excitement. One woman snapped a photo in the Adoration Chapel and says she got so much more. Maureen Kent has been attending Eucharistic Adoration at the church for more than 2 years. As she was kneeling, she wanted a picture of the Eucharist or host in the monstrance, the ornate gold stand which it is placed in. The picture showed a bright light, an image larger than a human, and appearing to hover next to the host on the altar. Catholics believe the consecrated host is Jesus Christ himself. Jesus is therefore in the Blessed Sacrament whole and entire, the soul, the body, and blood of Christ, with all their component parts. No photoshopping, Maureen says, no doctoring the digital image, just what she calls a great surprise when she looked at her cell phone screen.
So I took my iPhone out, no flash. I was not trying to be disrespectful or create any issue. And I snapped a simple picture. And, well, what was produced in the picture, there is a white light and a white image.
Her friends in the chapel also believe it is the Virgin Mary, also known as Our Lady of Perpetual Help. Currently, authentication is not a consideration by Maureen Kent or even the church. They do not wish to attract attention or stir up controversy. In the meantime, they are relishing what they call a miraculous moment, privileged to have seen and believed. Maureen Kent wasn't the only parishioner who took the miraculous photograph. There is a second photograph that was taken by a different parishioner at the same Adoration Chapel. In the second photograph, keep your focus on the illuminating light in the picture. Look at the church pews. The light does not appear to extend to the floor. It's almost floating. It is the Virgin Mary hovering just above the floor. Also, look at how bright the monstrance is. It's not clear that the monstrance is reflecting the light in the picture. It's almost as though the monstrance is part of the same light source. Why is the monstrance shaped like the sun? As St. John Vianney explains, Jesus' presence in the Holy Eucharist is like the sun shining its bright rays of grace over our souls, filling them with peace and joy, chasing away the dark clouds of sadness and loneliness that often try to come in our souls and in our lives. Eucharistic adoration is spiritual radiation therapy. When we're in the presence of Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, our very being, our very soul, and every cell of our body is bombarded by the holy presence of our Lord. It's rather like sitting in front of a block of plutonium, but the results are infinitely better. WGN-TV in Chicago has a news video on this story. Why did the Virgin Mary adore Jesus in the chapel? All Mary's life, taken as a whole, may be summed up in this one word, adoration. For adoration is the perfect service of God, and it embraces all the duties of the creature toward the Creator. It was Mary who first adored the incarnate Word. He was in her womb, and no one on earth knew of it. At Bethlehem, Mary was the first to adore her divine Son lying in the manger. She adored him with the perfect love of a virgin mother, the love of charity, as says the Holy Spirit. After Mary, Saint Joseph, the shepherds, then the Magi came to adore, but it was Mary who opened up that furrow of fire that was to spread over the world. And what beautiful things, what divine things Mary must have said, for hers was an ardent love whose depths we can never fathom. Mary continued to adore our Lord, first in his hidden life at Nazareth, afterwards in his apostolic life, and finally on Calvary, where her adoration became intense suffering. Notice the nature of Mary's adoration. She adored our Lord according to the different states of his life. Jesus' state determined the character of her adoration. Her adoration did not stay in a set groove. At one time, she adored God in her womb. At another, as poor and lowly in Bethlehem. Again, as laboring at Nazareth. And later on, as evangelizing and converting sinners. She adored him and his sufferings on Calvary by suffering with him. Her adoration was always in keeping with the sentiments of her divine Son, which were clearly revealed to her. Her love brought her into perfect conformity of thought and life with him. Excerpts taken from St. Peter Julian Aimard, Our Lady of the Most Blessed Sacrament. It doesn't take a genius to figure out that we are living in the time Jesus talked about, a time like the days of Noah and Lot, where violence, wickedness, sexual immorality, and homosexuality would control the minds of men and women alike. Take a look around you, turn on the TV, and you will see a world full of evil, corruption, violence, and sexual immorality. The Virgin Mary is not only pleading, but begging all of her children to follow her example and adore her beloved Son, not just once a week, but every day. Can we spend a holy hour before the Blessed Sacrament? Can we become victim souls? Do we even believe in penance and mortification? Can we make reparation for the many lost souls who are heading to eternal hellfire? Yes, my adorable Jesus. I will do penance and mortification. With Mary's help, I will become a victim soul. Here's a third miraculous photograph. A woman by the name of Lori is a parishioner who also goes to the same church, Our Lady of Perpetual Help. Lori took the third miraculous photograph. It's not the image of the Virgin Mary, but actually of an angel. Here's Lori's story as revealed on qembark.com. Lori said that she's been through a lot of strife in her life, including a battle with a rare form of cancer, but that her faith and deep belief in Jesus Christ has always helped her through dark times. In particular, Lori seems to know something about the reality of spiritual warfare, because at times, she has the ability to perceive the unseen or unnoticed, the spiritual. She considers this perception a gift, the purpose of which she is still hoping that God will reveal to her. Lori believes that the picture shows her guardian angel. She believes this because, simply, she asked her guardian angel to show herself next to Jesus. Lori's picture was taken on February 10, 2014 at 10:44 a.m. with an LG P769, an Android phone. Lori says that she took a rapid succession of photographs, perhaps five in total, and only one contained the image shown above. She says that she did not alter, retouch, or Photoshop the photograph in any way. The crucifix hangs above the main altar in the church. Behind it shows the doors to the Adoration Chapel, where the other two miraculous pictures were taken. Here's the normal crucifix picture. And here's the miraculous photograph of the guardian angel next to the crucifix. While Catholics adore and consume the consecrated host, Satan worshippers or Satanists steal the consecrated host in order to defile and desecrate Jesus Christ. You will never hear of hosts being stolen at a Baptist, Methodist, or any Protestant church because Satan worshippers know that the consecrated hosts only exist in a Catholic church. In Europe, a true market for consecrated hosts exists. They sell for 80 to 500 euros depending on the size of the host, the prominence of the church from which they were stolen, and who consecrated them. The highest price is placed on those that are consecrated in the churches of Rome, above all those closest to the Vatican. They are stolen in two ways, from the tabernacle, but also at the time of Holy Communion. Satanists are attacking Catholic churches, stealing the consecrated host, and desecrating it in horrific satanic rituals. The Eucharist is so holy. It is the true body and blood of Jesus, and the servants of Satan hate it so much that they want to destroy it. In Spain, there are satanic cults who have a high demand for consecrated hosts, so thieves steal the hosts to make a profit. Before the Satanist buyer makes the purchase, he requires footage that proves the host has been consecrated. This is how much these devil worshippers hate the Eucharist. They must know emphatically that it has been consecrated by a Catholic priest, not a Protestant pastor, not an evangelical pastor, but a Catholic priest. When a priest was ordained, his hands were anointed as the bishop intoned, "What these hands bless is truly blessed, and what these hands consecrate is truly consecrated." The anointed hands were then wrapped in a linen menutergium. The menutergium was later given to his mother, and when she died, her hands were wrapped in that sanctified linen. Anyone could guess that this was a ticket straight into heaven. In August 2014, organizers of a satanic black mass slated to take place in Oklahoma City face a lawsuit on grounds that the consecrated host used for the sacrilegious event is stolen. We are honored to represent Archbishop Coakley in this fight against the desecration of the Blessed Sacrament, attorney Michael Caspino told the National Catholic Register. The Archbishop should be lauded for his courageous stance against the enemies of the Church. Our legal theory is very simple, he continued. A consecrated Eucharist belongs to the Church. The Church has exercised dominion and control over the Eucharist for 2,000 years. The Satanists procured the consecrated host by illicit means, by theft or fraud. We are simply asking the court to return the stolen property to its rightful owner, the Roman Catholic Church. The lawsuit was filed in Oklahoma City District Court August 20th on behalf of the local archdiocese by Bush and Caspino. A few days, Oklahoma City's Archbishop voiced relief that Satanists organizing a black mass in the city returned a stolen host that was to be desecrated, but restated his concern that the event should happen at all. I am relieved that we have been able to secure the return of the sacred host and that we have prevented its desecration as part of a planned satanic ritual, Archbishop Paul Coakley said August 21st. I remain concerned about the dark powers that this satanic worship invites into our community and the spiritual danger that this poses to all who are involved in it, directly or indirectly. Regarding the Eucharist, here's a great article by Michael Foley from The Catholic Thing. Perhaps the most disconcerting Catholic doctrine is the real presence of Jesus Christ in the Blessed Sacrament. Many people today have the same reaction as those disciples who heard Jesus preach it for the first time in Capernaum and were scandalized. This saying is hard, and who can hear it? John 6:61. John says that after, many of his disciples stopped following him altogether. What is obviously so hard about this saying is that it suggests cannibalism. If Catholics believe the Eucharist really is the body and blood of Christ, then they believe they're eating human flesh and drinking human blood. The Romans accused Christians of cannibalism, and that charge has been made against Catholics in various ways ever since. But while Holy Communion does involve eating human flesh and blood, it is not true that it's cannibalistic. How so? The Eucharist is life. Cannibals eat what is dead. The Aztecs, the most notorious cannibalistic society in history, ate the beating hearts of victims, but they were still eating something doomed to die. And in the act of eating, it did die. By contrast, Christ is alive. He rose on the third day and is present in the Eucharist as fully alive. Indeed, he is life itself. Our reception of the Eucharist doesn't destroy or change that in any way. The Eucharist is the whole body and blood of Jesus Christ. Cannibals only take a part of their victims, but even the smallest particle of the Eucharist contains the entire body and blood of Christ. The familiar characteristics of space and matter don't apply. Consuming a larger host does not mean you get more of Christ's body and blood, nor does consuming a small host mean you get less. Even receiving from the precious cup is unnecessary. By concomitance, when a communicant receives the host, he also receives the precious blood. The Eucharist is the glorified body of Jesus Christ. Concomitance is possible because Christ's living and eternal body is forever reunited with his blood. Hence, receiving the former entails receiving the latter. Christ's risen body is not a resuscitated corpse like that of Lazarus, but an utterly transformed spiritual body. 1 Corinthians 15:44. Far different from the spatio-temporal body of our lowness. Philippians 3:21. Therefore, when a Catholic receives the Eucharist, he is receiving not just flesh, but glorified flesh. A resurrected and transfigured superbody that foreshadows the new reality of a new heaven and a new earth. Cannibalistic practices don't do that. The Eucharist contains the soul of Jesus Christ. Some cannibalistic societies eat the flesh or drink the blood of fallen warriors in the hopes of taking on their life force or their courage, or of destroying their spirit altogether, Yet precisely because the risen Jesus is alive, his immortal soul is united to his body and blood and inseparable from them in the Eucharist. The Eucharist contains the divinity of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus Christ is true God and true man, his divinity and his humanity are also inseparable. Consequently, in partaking of the human aspects of Christ, his body, blood, and soul, we also partake of his divine nature. This stands in sharp contrast to cannibals such as the Binderwars of central India, whose flesh-eating religious rituals tried to bring them closer to the gods but made them sink lower than most beasts. Putting all these elements together, we arrive at the Catholic formula. The Eucharist is the body and blood, soul and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Eucharist is not diminished. If Christ is entirely present in even the tiniest part of the host, then it follows that the living body and blood of Christ are not diminished by the act of receiving Holy Communion. More communicants does not mean less Christ left, and so on. The Eucharist consumes us. When you eat food, it becomes part of you. With the Eucharist, however, the opposite happens. We become a part of it. That is, in Holy Communion, we are made a part of the mystical body of Christ. In our Lord's words, those who eat his flesh and drink his blood abide in him, John 6:40. The Eucharist is nonviolent. Catholics understand the Mass as the non-bloody representation of the sacrifice of the cross. Christ, whose innocent blood was unjustly shed 2,000 years ago, is made available for his disciples under the appearance of bread and wine, but in a peaceful, non-violent way. Cannibalism is inherently violent and usually predicated on the assumption that the victim is guilty of a crime against society. Usually they are prisoners of war. All of this suggests that what happens at the Lord's table is fundamentally different than what happens in the dark rites of a depraved tribe. Indeed, from a metaphysical perspective, we can consider all cannibalistic customs, as opposed to those induced by derangement or starvation, as a perverse and even demonic mimicry of our holy communion with the risen Lord. Most anthropologists believe that cannibalism is intrinsically religious in nature. Just as all pagan blood sacrifices were distorted knockoffs of the one true sacrifice of Calvary, even if they took place before the crucifixion, so too all ritual acts of cannibalism are a distorted attempt to replace the bread of life with the mammon of one's own inequity. The disciples, scandalized by Jesus' hard saying, were right to be horrified by cannibalism, but wrong to identify it with what they were hearing. The Eucharist is not another form of cannibalism. On the contrary, it is a holy union with life itself, which all cannibal acts blindly seek but never obtain. In this respect, Holy Communion is actually the supreme instance of anti-cannibalism, an expose of all evil imposters for what they are. Jesus made the difference clear enough when he referred to himself as the living bread, John 6:41. So if anyone asks, now you know. Catholics believe that the Eucharist is the medicine of immortality, the divine blood transfusion. St. Ephrem said, one particle from the Eucharistic bread is able to sanctify thousands. Receiving daily Eucharist brings a daily attitude of gratitude, which leads to beatitude of becoming more open to grace and inspiration. If you talk to those who frequent Eucharistic adoration, sign up for holy hours, or even make just occasional church visits to pray privately in front of the Blessed Sacrament, you'll likely hear about the healing, transformative power of this particular prayer practice. But for many other Catholics, adoration can be a little intimidating. What do we do while we sit in the quiet? Are there special prayers? Well, you can pray the Holy Rosary, the Divine Mercy Chaplet, or Stations of the Cross, etc. Also, you can meditate on Psalms and Scriptures. Monsignor Charles Murphy, author of Eucharistic Adoration, Holy Hour Meditations on the Seven Last Words of Christ, said the practice of Eucharistic Adoration grew out of the challenge Jesus made to the sleeping apostles during the agony in the garden. Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? An hour actually passes very quickly, but if done on a regular basis, it establishes a structure for our entire week, Monsignor Murphy told our Sunday visitor, explaining that after the Protestant Reformation, the enduring presence of Jesus in the Eucharist and the adoration of the Blessed Sacrament outside of Mass received new emphasis. With the help of saints like St. Charles Borromeo, the tabernacle became a more important part of every sanctuary. After the Second Vatican Council, emphasis was placed, rightly, upon the Eucharistic celebration as an action requiring the active participation of the people, he said. A nice balance is now being achieved between action and contemplation through the practice of Eucharistic adoration. Adoration, when the Eucharist is exposed in a monstrance so that people may pray while looking at the Blessed Sacrament, is an extension of what happens during every Mass and comes in several forms. Some parishes may offer adoration on a particular day. Other parishes may offer nocturnal adoration, which goes through the night, or perpetual adoration, which is held on a 24/7 basis. Coming to Jesus once a week? No, that is not enough. We must strive to spend a holy hour daily. If the Blessed Virgin Mary adores her beloved Son in the chapel, how much more of reverence and love do we come before Jesus? If Jesus returns to earth, will you stop everything and run to welcome him? If Jesus appears in church today, many Christians will run to see the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the Creator of heaven and earth. Churchgoers will find long lines in the church where Jesus appears, and mass transit will be an utter chaos. Crowds of people will board trains and buses, running and screaming in absolute joy and excitement. If Jesus appears in a church, people around the world will light up social media. The President of the United States, European Union heads of state and government, and other world leaders will immediately visit the church where Jesus appears. The Secret Service agents stand guard at the church door. The National Guard and soldiers patrol outside the church. And military helicopters circle overhead. Everyone wants to see Jesus. Churchgoers wait for hours to get in the church and to catch a glimpse of Jesus. As soon as the church door opens, people will start to flood in and form a massive crowd. If Jesus were actually visible in church, everyone would run to welcome him. But he remains hidden in the sacred host under the appearance of bread, because he is calling us to faith that we may come to him in humility. Nowadays, church pews are empty and many people no longer believe in the real presence of Jesus. Eucharistic adoration is available in some churches, but very few people take the time to spend a holy hour with the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. If Jesus returns to earth, will you stop everything and run to welcome him? And Jesus said to Peter, "So could you not watch with me 1 hour?" How would you respond to Jesus' request? Many Christians have no time for Jesus. They say, "Sorry, Jesus, I don't have an hour. I have to make money. I have hobbies to do, bucket lists to accomplish, clothes to buy at shopping malls, vacation destinations, and beaches to enjoy. Dear Jesus, I love you, but I can't spend an hour with you before the Blessed Sacrament. I don't feel like driving to a local church for adoration." Polls show that more than 60% of American Catholics say they do not believe in the real presence, that Jesus Christ is bodily present in the Eucharist. What does this mean? Are U.S. Catholics lacking in faith or poorly catechized? Or are there more basic flaws in our current understanding of the real presence? Father John Hardin once said, "The single unifying feature of the 40,000-plus Protestant denominations is their rejection of the real presence of our Lord in the Holy Eucharist." Of all of the definitions that anyone could come up with for Protestantism, that one is the most accurate. Those self-professed Christians who reject the real presence of Christ in the Blessed Sacrament. It's really as simple as that. What the few Catholics in the church today who still believe in the real presence are faced with is nothing less than perhaps the most daunting task in our 2,000-year history. A restoration of belief in the real presence in the face of internal attacks against it. If a Christian denies the true presence of Christ in the Blessed Sacrament, he can be counted among the many disciples that left him. Of all the teachings in the New Testament, there's only one teaching that after hearing it, many of his disciples left him. And Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day, for my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. In fact, after he promised the Blessed Sacrament, many of the Jews who heard him did not believe. "This is intolerable language," they said. "This is a hard teaching. Who can accept it?" After this, we are told, many of his disciples left him and stopped going with him. And the evangelist further explains that Jesus knew from the outset those who did not believe and who it was that would betray him. We might add that when we are told that the Savior knew who did not believe, that was not only contemporary, but all future knowledge. He foresaw who would and who would not believe, and let us make sure that the evangelist's juxtaposition of those who did not believe and those who would betray him is the relationship of cause and effect. All the traitors of Christ have been those who, having believed, stopped believing. Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of the Spirit and life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe." For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him. He went on to say, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled them." From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. "You do not want to leave too, do you?" Jesus asked the 12. Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." Here's a great article by Melinda Selmis from Ontario, Canada. Most Catholics know we are supposed to attend Sunday Mass every week and observe various holy days of obligation throughout the year. It's an obligation, however, that many do not observe. When the pews of our sleepy rural parish were unexpectedly full, my parish priest jokingly said, "There must be nothing going on in town today." I suspect part of the reason so many Catholics ignore the Sunday obligation is, counterintuitively, the very word obligation. Our culture is not one that deals well with concepts like duty and obedience. The words, "I was just following orders," is synonymous with mindless compliance, while the character of the dutiful wife or obedient child tends to be the subject of ridicule or pity. As a result, we end up with a divide within the church. On the one hand, there are those who attend Mass only when there is an important event, when it happens to be convenient, or when they are especially in need of divine help. On the other, you have Catholics who dutifully obey the precepts of the church, but who too often look down on those who don't. The Sunday obligation is not a chore the church exacts from her faithful children, but a manifestation of her maternal concern. We are called to Mass every Sunday in much the same way children are called to the dinner table every evening. When the church tells us that we are obligated to attend, she's telling us how often we need to receive sacramental nourishment in order to remain spiritually healthy. Choosing to skip Mass for trivial reasons is a mortal sin because it is a kind of willful self-neglect. It's like a businessman who chooses to deprive his body of adequate food because meals cut into the time he has to maximize his profits. Being unable to attend for good reasons is not sinful, but it is a privation, like a mother who skips meals because she only has enough to feed her children. Christ's body is true bread, and the sustenance which we receive in the Eucharist is even more important to our well-being than physical food. Indeed, physical hunger is ultimately a sign that helps to illustrate our spiritual needs. After Christ feeds the multitudes in John 6, the people he has fed go looking for him the next day. When they finally track him down, Christ reveals their motives. "You are not looking for me because you have seen the signs, but because you had all the bread you wanted to eat." John 6:26. The experience of being satisfied with food after a long day clearly made a deep impression. No doubt, some of these people were poor and rarely had enough to eat. Others were dreaming of a world in which the Jewish people would once more be fed directly by the hand of God, as they were in the wilderness under Moses. For them, the multiplication of the loaves did not merely point toward the relief of physical hunger, but also toward political liberation from the power of Rome. The manna of Exodus had freed the Jewish people to escape the flesh pots of Egypt. Thus, bread represented both nourishment and freedom. When Christ answers them, he tries to guide their thinking away from short-term physical and political hopes. Do not work for food that perishes, he tells them, but for the food that endures for eternal life, John 6:27. Later, he clarifies, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world, John 6:51. Everyone knows it is necessary to eat in order to stay alive, and if we don't have enough food, it causes health problems. It is the same with the Mass. This is where we come in order to receive the lifeblood that nourishes our souls and prepares them to be born to eternal life. When a person misses Mass for serious reasons, Catholic tradition offers ways of observing the Sabbath until it is possible to return to the sacraments, emergency rations for the soul, if you will. Individuals and families are encouraged to participate in the liturgy of the Word and to set aside time for Sunday prayer. An act of spiritual communion can also be made anywhere and at any time by turning one's heart towards the tabernacle and inviting Jesus' real presence in the sacrament to spiritually nourish and sustain the soul. Parish communities should also help absent parishioners return to the Mass. One of the risks of seeing attendance as a personal accomplishment is that it can blind us to the fact that access to the Eucharist is achieved through community. Consider, for example, the story of the wedding at Cana, a gospel passage redolent with Eucharistic symbolism. Here we find there isn't enough wine to go around. Some of the guests are going to be excluded from full participation in the joy of the wedding celebration. Mary's solicitude at Cana shows us that we can enable others to participate by being aware of their needs and offering assistance. The hosts of the wedding know they are running out of wine, but they don't know who to ask for help. They have no idea Christ is on hand, able to work a miracle. People within a parish community might want to attend Mass regularly, but they might be unsure how to ask for the support they need. An older person who has lost their driver's license might feel uncomfortable asking for a ride. A single mother caring for a chronically ill child might be embarrassed to admit she can't afford a babysitter Sunday mornings. Parishioners can imitate Mary by taking a friendly interest and getting an idea of what obstacles are preventing folks from attending more regularly. People who are afraid of asking for help are often grateful for a simple, gracious offer of assistance. If we see the sacrament as a gift and ourselves as conduits through which others are enabled to receive it, we can both avoid the silliness of spiritual pride and also help to build vibrant Eucharistic communities where everyone is able to enjoy the bounteous generosity of God. Padre Pio had a great devotion to the Eucharist. He once said, "It would be easier for the world to survive without the Son than to do so without the Holy Mass." Catholics should adore the Blessed Sacrament daily, not weekly, because the angels and saints adore Jesus Christ every day in heaven. And if we're not perfect, we must be purified in purgatory. Judging from our conversations with many Catholics, no one wants to be purified in purgatory. Did we mention that the purifying fires are quite painful? God bless you all.